Thank you, everyone, for coming to the talk of Polish variable fonts or improving variable fonts by Erwin Denison. I read Polish funny, by the way, now because variable font was announced in Poland in the API, so variable font is Polish. Anyway. He's a creator of font creator. That's a font editor on Windows, and he's been a business for a very long time. And he's going to talk about polishing variable fonts. So yeah, let's take it away.
Thank you for joining my presentation. I am Erwin Denissen, founder of HiLogic, and started development of Font Creator back in 1997. It was a graduation project, and Font Creator has been improved over the years. It now allows you to visually edit open type layout features, but also supports Adobe FIA and Microsoft Fold feature code. It has advanced validation and proofing tools and comes with its own shaping engine. It supports UFO and Design Space version 5, so you can subset variable fonts, including change of default location, extrapolation, and discrete access. Font Creator is the only native font editor with such capabilities. It is made to run on Windows, but there are also ways to use it on a Mac. During this session, I will focus on how to detect and fix interpolation issues in variable fonts. I will also show what specific font properties are important so you can successfully export variable fonts, design space subsets, and static instances. As a bonus, I will also show how to add contextual kerning, also known as triplets, to a variable font. Feel free to ask any questions. However, since the presentation is pre-recorded, I will answer any questions afterwards. Variable fonts. The internal structures and properties to make a variable font are dictated by the OpenType specification. Font Creator tries to expose as much of this data as possible. To make a variable font, you will need to add one or more axes, at least two masters with compatible glyph outlines. And with variable fonts, overlaps are explicitly allowed, so people who are used to make traditional fonts might need to get used to this new approach. At some point, you will most likely add OpenType layout features such as glyphs, substitutions, kerning, and mark-to-base positioning rules. With variable fonts, this requires you to work with discipline. Interpolation issues. That's what this presentation is all about, of course. So even existing variable fonts can still contain interpolation issues. Sure, the glyph outlines between masters are compatible, but that does not guarantee it's all meant to be. Font Creator cannot detect design flaws like kinks, but it can locate and fix these issues. A mix of contours and glyph members, start points that are not matching, and different contour directions between the masters. We have inspected more than 100 variable fonts and discovered that 60% of them have such issues. That includes fonts that are distributed with Windows and Mac OS. Now, I will now make a demo font that shows these issues. I will add four glyph outlines to make the word nail. But before I do that, I will also make some settings changes. I want to show the grid. snap to points. Now let's try to draw an N. I will make changes if necessary later on, because I'm not a real designer. I'm a font developer. So this is always challenging for me. Well, it's not that bad for first approach. That becomes a little too curvy. I want to stick with straight lines. Okay, well, that looks like an N to me. I also want to make an A, and I will use two contours for this one. I also set the advance width to 1600, like the same as the A, as the N. Well, it looks like an A to me, so let's move on to the I. And I want to make the left and right side bearings 160 both. And finally, I want to make an L. Let's make that one a little shorter, the right side there. Okay, so now we have four letters, nil, and well, I don't think this is the best A I've ever made, but for the purpose of showing the glyph issues, the interpolation issues, we can move on with this. So what I want to do next is to turn this font into a variable font, and I will add a bold master. I will copy the current layer. So we have now a new master, a bold master. And that also has the same outlines as the default one. It's all set. The only thing that is still important, of course, is the weight axis. So let me add that as well. And now we're all set. We have a regular and a bold. To make the bold look really bold, I use a transform script and I apply it to all glyphs, and only for the active layer, which is currently the bold one. So here you see the bold layer, and we can interpolate . So all good. Now I want to show the interpolation issues that FontRater can detect. Let's set a different starting point here. Well, obviously we have to select the master, the bold one. And when we now interpolate, it's still compatible, but certainly not what we intend. For the A, I will merge the regular outline. And now we have an incompatible masters, because the bold version has two outlines. So interpolation is no longer possible. The eye. For the eye, I want to change the direction of the bold master. Still, the outlines are compatible, but you see the interpolation goes wrong. In FontCreator, the masters and layers panel shows specific issues like this. This is the direction of the outline, which is no longer compatible. For the A, it is the outline itself. And here we change the starting point, so we show an S to indicate that issue. And for the L, I want to swap the contours. And to do so, I will just send this one to the back. And to illustrate what happens here, you see the contours are swapped. Since we already used the S for start point, we use the W for this interpolation issue. So how can we fix these issues? Now, well, obviously the A, we can't fix that one, but we can fix the others. We just select all glyphs and click the auto fix interpolation issues. And when we do that, we should see that it's fixed in the preview. So the N, the I, and the L are now compatible, and there are no longer interpolation issues. And the A still has issues, and well, we can manually fix that by also combining the contours in the bold master. Next, I will open several variable fonts to see if they have such interpolation issues. Let's start with clavichord variable. This is a curvy black letter variable font from David Jonathan Ross. It contains an optical axis which forces a consistent hairline thickness of half a point. Well, to manually inspect issues is very tedious, and in most cases these interpolation issues are very hard to discover. So we have made a validation wizard which can find numerous glyph outline issues, like overlapping components, duplicate components, contours with 1 or 2 points, duplicate contours, intersecting contours, but we now focus on the interpolation issues. In this font, FontCreator has detected 3 glyphs with interpolation issues. Let's click left to see them, all 3. And let's see if we can manually detect the problem. Well, you see here are 2 contours that are swapped while interpolating. That's obviously an issue. We can fix it. And here we have another glyph. This one is a little harder to see. Actually, this contour has a different start point. You can see it in point mode. You see the points are moving along the line. We can fix that as well. And now it behaves as intended. And the last glyph here . This is also a starting point issue, and we can easily fix that as well. The next font is Fit Beta. It is a font that contains Latin and I believe Armenian. Let me see. It's made by Gore Jihanian and David Jonathan Ross. It's a very complex font, so it took a while to open it in Font Creator. It has 9 axes and 143 masters. Fortunately, due to the nature of the glyph outlines, the validation won't take that long. Here we find 6 glyphs with issues, and let's inspect 1 or 2. As you can see, there are a lot of glyph layers. It is almost impossible to find the interpolation issues manually. You can try to change the location of the axis. But there are so many axes, so many masters, it would take a lot of time. We have a special feature here, show compatibility issues, and that will show where the issues are located. Thus, this helps to find the exact cause of the problem. And even with this complex font, it is still not easy to spot it, as you can see. Well, let's see if we can find. Maybe you already noticed the problem. So you can see, even with the tools, now I see something going wrong here. Well, we can try to fix this issue. So yes, I think it's solved now. The other issues are probably also taking some time to find, but I want to move on to the next font. This is a material symbol outlined, symbols outlined. It's made by Thomas Finney. It's a font also with many axes, and it also takes some time to open in Font Creator. It has a cool feature that allows you to fill your glyph outline. Well, let's see if we can spot some issues. Okay, that's too hard to spot. Let's use the font validation feature. This will take some time because this is a very complex font with a lot of axes, and the glyph outlines are rather complex as well. Okay, maybe the area chart looks a little strange in this one as well. Let's preview them here. And what more? Lens blur also. Let's see what's going on here. There's something wrong with the contours. They are swapped here. Let me see what triggers it. It's the optical size. Now let's fix this one. Now it's fixed. And let's also try to fix these interpolation issues as well. Here they're swapped as well. And then now it's fixed. This one has no issues anymore, I think. Let's spot them. This one has a lot of irregularities. It has fixed them, but there are still problems, probably because the glyph outlines itself, the design is not correct here. So that should be fixed, and then interpolation should also work again. All right, let's move on to another font. This time, this is a font with color, Cairo Play. And Cairo Play is a typeface with both Latin and Arabic. It has an additional dimension, as I mentioned, it's the color. The accents, the marks are colored. And here's the Arabic script, and a lot of green here. So this is a color font made of color version 0. Well, let's see if there are interpolation issues. This goes rather fast. 58 problems, that's a lot. Let's see if we can spot them. Well, here you obviously see something's going wrong. And here you also see the dots are moving and swapping around. Well, let's see if we can fix this. It is now fixed, but I have now fixed the monochrome glyph here, but we are looking at the color variant. So the issue is still here, and that's because, well, this is another glyph. And to fix all issues, We have to fix this as well, and this and this. If we fix these, then you will probably also see here are more. Let's fix them all and see if that solves the problem. That's looking better. So now the used glyphs are also no longer having interpolation issues, so the color font is also looking good. The last font is Cantumbro Pro. It's a variable font by Tab Sovrijet. I hope I pronounced his name correctly. And for this font, we use the U4 source files, actually the design space. This is the upright. And let's also open the italic. Let's see if there are any interpolation issues. No. And here, also no. So both the upright and italic don't have interpolation issues. That's good. It all looks fine to me. Now I want to move on to the next part. That's about the design space version 5. Until recently, the de facto exchange format for variable fonts had several shortcomings, like lack of style for attributes, the access values. This is now greatly improved with version 5 of the design space. It even comes with ways to define subsets of a variable font. And that's what I want to show you with this font right now. Font Creator fully supports these new subset capabilities. So you can define multiple subsets, you can change the default location, mark an axis as discrete, and extrapolate axis. To illustrate this, I will combine the upright and italic families into one typeface. Merging the two will most likely cause interpolation issues, especially as numerous letters in the italic font are drawn in a different style. In this case, we will just accept this because it is a common logical behavior. We will first add an italic axis, as that differentiates the two. So we will add an italic axis here. And we will set it as discrete, because you can't interpolate between the two. Then we add the italic axis to the italic font. And now we will add the italic masses to the upright. So we have the three uprights, and we will now add the italics. In Font Creator, you can still interpolate the italic axis, which is of course not intended to be. They, on exporting them, they will still be two different variable fonts. Let's type some text here. fix the underline and the strikeout position. Yes, that's looking good. Well, the preview works perfectly. But what happens if we export it as a font? Well, we'll export it as a web font, so we can test it in a web browser. And now you see it exports only the upright variant, because Font Creator knows it's the italic axis is a discrete axis, so it will only export the default one. Now we want also to export the italic variant. So for this to accomplish, we go to the export settings and we define subsets. We will define an upright. And the upright has only a weight axis. And to illustrate the capabilities of Font Creator, we will change the minimum axis value, which currently is, I believe, 100, and the maximum value is currently 700, and we will increase that so it will extrapolate. And the default was initially 400, and we will change the default value to 500. We will also add an italic subset, and in this case we will also use a weight. For the weight, we will use the defaults, so we leave these empty, and we also add the italic because we want this to be 1. To make it complete, we will also add axis values. And here they are, but we also want to add them for 800 and 900 weight value. Extra bold. And for 900, we call it black. Now we will auto-generate the two subsets. Now I'm exporting the two subsets, but I forgot to also generate the instances. So now we have a complete set. You will see the thin is actually 16 and black is 234. That's because the weight axis has mappings. Let's export them. Actually, for the second time now, so we will probably have the orders also. Here they are exported. This is the upright. It starts with 200, that's extra light, and it goes to black. This is extrapolated, and the italic starts with thin, the defaults, and it ends with the bold one. Well, we can also show this in SAMSA, for example. Let's see the upright. And you will see it contains the extra bold and the black, and it interpolates. One last thing I want to show today is kerning triplets. And for this we will use the italic font of Katamari Pro, We will open the OpenType Designer and we will use some preview text. And here you see there is already some kerning in the font. That's good. And here, and here, and here. This is all looking fine, except for the capital letter A and the capital letter L and A, because here you see there could be some other distances. Let me show the slide, if I can grab it. Oh, it's already there, great. So I'm sure you've been there. All side bearings and kerning pairs look great, but while further reviewing the flow of your kerning text, you spot some more issues. This time adjusting a single kerning pair won't do, as the problem relates to more than a pair of characters. Most of the time it looks great, but it doesn't look right with specific surrounding characters. There are several solutions to overcome collisions or incorrect spacing between a range of characters. One of them is contextual kerning. A regular kerning remains, so we go from there to add additional spacing. So here we have no kerning. Here we have kerning. But say we want to change the kerning a little, because we think this could be slightly tighter together. Let's say we like this. And for the thin italic, we use this value. And for the bold italic, we don't want to have too much movement. This looks pretty good to me. We can even interpolate instantly. This looks great. And now we want to do this with the L and the quote right. We want to make some changes here. Actually, I want to put this value here. I might be exaggerating a little to show the concept. So this is all looking good in this with this text, but here you see the L and the A are colliding a lot. So this collision, I want to fix this, but this is only happening in this specific situation, because here it looks pretty cool. So how can we fix this? Let's focus on the last piece of text here. And let's add a new pair adjustment lookup. And we name it pair adjustment triplet. And here we add the quote right. And here the A. Well, here we can see we have to move this a little further away. Let's see if this works. It actually looks good, but you see the quote right is still too far to the left, so we want to move that as well. So let's see if we can move it this way. Yep, this is looking good in my opinion. Let's see if we can fix it here as well. And you see when we make changes here to correct it, you will also see in other places it will go wrong again. So we are actually making a conflicting solution here. So when you only look at the L quote right A, it looks rather cool. But with the B quote right A, it's looking awful. So what can we do? We can remove this pair adjustment triplet because we don't want to have it all the time. We only want it in a specific situation. And for this to make happen, we add a change context positioning lookup. And here we add the backtrack. That will be the capital L. And for the input, we will use the quote right. And we will also use the A. And now this is the input, and we will only apply this when it's preceded by a capital L. And then we want to execute the pair adjustment triplet. So now this will only occur in this situation, and this is all looking great to me. So this is kerning triplets. Here's the code you can use. This is feature code, via code. And these are the fonts I used during this presentation. During this presentation, I showed you how to detect and fix interpolation issues. I also showed you how you can make use of the design space version 5. With the subsets, and I also covered the kerning triplets. I hope you enjoyed the presentation, and thank you for having me.